Hello, good evening, Fountain of Life. I'm so glad that you're joining me on this Facebook Live broadcast here on this Wednesday, this beautiful day here in late May. And we're excited about what God is doing, amen, at Fountain of Life and through His Word. And we're glad that you're joined us tonight. Tonight we're going to have an awesome Bible study, I believe, that's entitled, How Can I Be Happy? And so we're going to talk about that in just a few moments. But before I do that, I just wanted to take a moment and pray with you and welcome those who are joining us via Facebook Live. Let me just say that our church is reopened tonight. We're having a Bible study at Fountain of Life, and we're excited about that. Next Sunday, we're going to be having our service, not as a normal type of a service, but in a kind of a different type of a way. As you enter the sanctuary, you'll see that there's been a lot of changes made, and we're excited that we're able to at least get back together to see one another's face, worship in a corporate setting, and listen to the Word of God being preached and experience the presence of God. I don't know about you, but I'm just hungry to get back into the presence of God in a corporate setting. Certainly, you know, we experience the presence of God every day when we're, you know, having our personal devotions. But there's something about coming together. And that's why the book of Hebrews tells us in Hebrews chapter 10 and verse, I believe it's 25, tells us, do not forsake the assembling of yourselves together as the manner of some is, but all the more as you see the day approaching. In other words, the closer we're getting to get to the coming of Christ, the more we're supposed to be back together, not less. But anyway, I've decided, you know, since there's a lot of people in our congregation who aren't able to make it on Wednesday, there's a lot of people that are joining us online on Facebook, that I've just decided, even though we're having a Bible study at the church on Wednesday night, I've decided to make a Bible study every week for a while, and I just teach God's Word for those who can't make it. Maybe you're getting home from work late. Maybe you just physically can't come because you're kind of an at-risk person for COVID-19. We understand all of that, and let me just say that an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure, to quote an old saying. That's not the Bible, but it's some good, sound, solid wisdom anyway. But let me just pray for you today as we get going. Let me just pray. Lord, I just pray for this Bible study tonight. I pray that you would anoint my mind and my heart as I share your word tonight. And I pray, Lord, that you would be with every person that's joining us, every person that's listening, God, those that are in their home, those that are being, you know, faithful to your word, to study it, Lord, on this Wednesday evening. God, I pray a special blessing upon them. Lord, I pray for all the members of our congregation, Lord, that you would keep them, God, close to you at this time. Put your arms around them, guide them, direct them in every single way in their life. Provide for them, Lord, and we'll give you thanks for that in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Anyhow, I'm so excited to teach God's Word to you. Now, let me just say that all of the instructions about what we're doing at Fountain of Life to reopen can be found on our website. If you'll just go to folcc.org, you will find a link there. It's a little red button just right at the top of our homepage, and it's a link to reopening our church. There's numerous things that we're trying to do in order to follow Governor Abbott's direction, and I think we're going to be absolutely safe as we come back together. I'm pumped about this. This is the very best thing to do. Okay, let's just jump right in here. You know, let me just say something first. If you really need to bring a pencil and a paper, or take notes on your phone or on your laptop or whatever, if you possibly can, because I'm going to be giving you a long kind of a detailed outline tonight. So I'm going to go kind of slow, and I hope that you can enjoy this. But this is not really a subject that you can just really whiz over really quick. Ah, yeah, now I know how to be happy. No problem. No, it's something really that if you had it and you looked at it every day and meditated on it for 2 or 3 weeks, it really might powerfully impact your life. So let me ask you this. We're going to take a look at this question. How can I be happy? And that's really one of the universal questions of life. In fact, Solomon asked this question some 3,000 years ago. And so let me, if you have the book, your Bible, you can turn to Ecclesiastes chapter 6 and verse number 6. And this is what it says in the Living Bible. Now, I know that this is a paraphrase, but I like it sometimes, kind of some other person's comments on the scripture. He says this, it says, though a man lives 1,000 years twice over, but doesn't find contentment, what's the use? That's an interesting paraphrase of that verse. Let me read it to you out of the New King James Version. Ecclesiastes chapter 6 and verse number 6 says, even if he lives 1,000 years twice, boy, that'd be a long life, wouldn't it, to live 2,000 years, but has not seen goodness, then he asks the question, don't all go to the same place? Don't all go to one place? And so he's saying, look, everybody dies at the end. So, I mean, like, what's the purpose, you know, of all of this? So he was really searching and seeking for answers during that time period. In other words, he was saying, what does it matter how long I live if I don't enjoy life while I'm living? And so Solomon, what he did was he began a lifelong search for satisfaction. Ecclesiastes chapter 2 and verse number 1 says this. Let me read it to you from the Good News Version, and then I'm going to read it from the NIV. It says, Solomon said, I decided to enjoy myself and find out what happiness is. Now, that's the Good News Version. Here's from the NIV. He said, in my heart, excuse me, Ecclesiastes, what is that? Yeah, 2 and verse 1. He says, I thought in my heart, come now, I will test you with pleasure to find out what is good. So he went on this search to find out what happiness really was. And I'll just tell you, let me say this about Solomon. Solomon was uniquely qualified for his search for happiness. The Bible says that he was the wisest man who ever lived. Not only that, he was also the wealthiest man who had ever lived, at least up to that time. He had both the brains and the bucks, we could say, to do his research and to try to figure out what would make him happy. And of course, since he was the king, he could do whatever he wanted. And so he no doubt could create a lot of free time for himself. So he actually accomplished a lot with his life, probably much more than most of us would ever dream of. And so what he said, I'm going to take this very seriously. I'm going to take both my mind and my money and my time, and I'm going to try to discover what it is that makes people happy. And so he wrote about this in Ecclesiastes chapter 2. And what he did was he searched out five different things. And this is what he said. He said, I tried education, pleasure, achievement, wealth, and success. And he said that the bottom line was that none of these things ultimately satisfied. Now, he didn't say that they were wrong things. In fact, many of these things are not wrong at all. We should be working towards these things, but actually, they're not a source of lasting happiness. And it's interesting that in today's culture, this is what the world really tries to instill in people, that this will make you happy, these five things. And so let's take a look at them just kind of one by one tonight. The first thing he said was that he talked about education. The Living Bible in Ecclesiastes 1, verses 16 to 18, the Living Bible says, I am better, this is Solomon talking, he says, I'm better educated than any of the kings before me. And then he goes on to say, but the more my wisdom, the more my grief. So let me read that to you out of the New International Version today, Ecclesiastes 1, 16 through 18. He said, I thought to myself, look, I have grown and increased in wisdom more than anyone who has ruled over Jerusalem before me. I have experienced much of wisdom and knowledge. Verse 17, then I applied myself to the understanding of wisdom and also of madness and folly, but I learned this, that this too is a chasing after the wind. And then he gives this little proverb. He says, for with much wisdom comes much sorrow. The more knowledge, the more grief. And so what he says is education and wisdom, searching these things out, doesn't actually give a person satisfaction in life. It doesn't make them happy. And then the next thing that Solomon said was, I think I'll try out pleasure. All right. So let me read this to you today. I'm going to read just some phrases today out of the New International Version today, verses 1 through 3, and then verse number 10. This is what he says of chapter 2. He said, I tested pleasure and laughter. I tried cheering myself with wine and having a good time. I acquired a harem. I denied myself nothing my eyes desired. I refused. My heart had no pleasure, but it proved to be meaningless. And so what he was really saying was, I looked at pleasure, and pleasure didn't ultimately give me that sense of happiness. He said, the first thing that I tried was laughter, okay? He said, I'll hang out in the comedy clubs, you know, I'm going to, you know, watch, you know, funny shows, and, you know, and I'm going to tell jokes. I'm going to have a lot of comedy in my life to try to cheer me up. That will make me happy. Now, don't get me wrong. I believe in laughter. We ought to laugh, right? Christians are joyful people. We have a good sense of humor. In fact, if you don't have any humor at all, you know, I kind of worry about you. And because we know that God laughs. He has a sense of humor. But I've discovered that in our society, there's a whole lot of laughter without really having a sense of happiness. Because laughter doesn't laugh, right? Last. It's a temporary relief and a lift. It's a momentary relief. And a lot of times laughter just really kind of masks the real problem. And it certainly isn't the most ultimate, all important thing in life to be able to laugh. And so laughter really doesn't bring happiness. It's just a simple little thing that just kind of lifts our spirits for a moment. Then, of course, he tried wine. He said, I'm cheering myself up on wine. That's that oldest mood-enhancing drug in the world. In other words, he said, I'm going to be at all the parties. I'm going to go from one to the next. I'm going to become a wine connoisseur. That's going to make me happy. I always think that it's kind of funny, you know. I've never been to any happy hours, okay? But, you know, I see those things advertised, you know. But, you know, really, you have to call it a happy hour. I think that a lot of people who are unhappy go to happy hour to try to find happiness. But they really don't find happiness. In fact, many people like that are miserable with their lives. So wine and alcohol, drugs, those things can't really make a person happy. In fact, a lot of times all they do is complicate your life, causing more and more problems over and over and over again. Anybody, you know, who really is, you know, aware of themselves understands that. Then he said, you know, I'm gonna just, you know, have good times. You know, I'm gonna be a party animal, dance, you know, be a part of the social scene. I'm gonna go out and have fun. I'll just go from one party to the next. But it was fun, but, you know, nothing lasted. The social scene didn't satisfy Solomon. And so then in Ecclesiastes chapter 2 and verse number 8, the New International Version, it says, well, I think I'll go buy myself a harem, okay? So what he said is, I'm going to try sexual escapades. The new Good News translation says, I had all the women a man could want, and then some. Okay, so that was Solomon, all right? And the Bible tells us that Solomon, as a king, actually had 700 wives, 300 paid mistresses. You know, I mean, he just took polygamy to an extreme, right? I mean, you know, he said, talk about sexual conquest. You know, I went the limit, you know. And Solomon said, ultimately, Solomon said that that didn't satisfy. In fact, if you really study Solomon's life, you would see that all of his, those wives from other nations and other religions, they actually led his heart away from God. And those things like that will lead a person on a lifestyle that takes you further and further away from God. And so, Solomon's really saying here, he's saying that if you think that, you know, having an affair or having multiple partners in life, if that's going to make you happy, that's going to satisfy you, you've really got another thing coming. Because I think that people discover that what happens is that their emptiness just increases as those numbers go up. And, you know, one of the things that Solomon said, he said, I denied myself nothing. I refused my heart no pleasure. He said he just took life to the limit and indulged in everything. And if it, you know, he kind of lived by that old saying, if it feels good, do it. And he did everything that he could, and even some more. But his bottom line on that was that pleasure promises so much more than it can actually deliver. It accomplishes nothing, actually. It doesn't last, and ultimately it leaves you bored. And, you know, I think that the most bored people on earth are just living for pleasure. You know, they can, a lot of people are wealthy, they can afford anything that they want, and they're really kind of bored stiff, you know. They've done everything, they've tried everything, you know, they've, you know, been around the block, and if you're seeking pleasure, you know, your happiness and pleasure, ultimately, you're not going to find it there. You know, there's a little saying, sometimes you see a sticker, you know, bumper sticker says, you know, are we having fun yet? It's just like you're supposed to be having fun, but you're not. So ultimately, even sexual pleasure, that's not going to make a person happy in their life. And I think that God created the institution of marriage, you know, in a beautiful way, because he understood that it was relationships that ultimately cause our lives to have joy and peace and happiness. We're talking about how to be happy. And then Solomon said, I'm going to try some work. I'll work hard. I'll achieve. He said, I'm just going to immerse myself in work. So let me read this to you today out of the New King James Version. Ecclesiastes chapter 2, verses 4 and 5. Ecclesiastes 2, 4 and 5. Now listen to everything that Solomon thought. If I achieve all of this, man, I'm going to be so happy. Ecclesiastes chapter 2, verses 4 and 5. He said, I made my works great. I built myself houses. By the way, his house took 14 years to build. I planted myself vineyards. I made myself gardens and orchards, and I planted all kinds of fruit trees in them. I made myself water pools from which to water the growing trees of the grove. I acquired male and female servants and had servants born in my house. And so all of these things, ultimately did not bring him happiness. Because ultimately, in verse number 20, this is what Solomon had to say about all of his hard work, out of all of his achievement. He said, therefore, I turned my heart and despaired of all the labor in which I had toiled under the sun. In other words, he looked at all that stuff that he had done, all of his achievements, and man, his achievements were great, you know, but they did not bring him happiness. You know, all the public works things that he did. I was doing some research and I discovered something from Lyndon B. Johnson, okay? He was at one time president of the United States. He's gone now. He's passed away. But, he had a lot of accomplishments in his lifetimes, you know, as an individual. I mean, you may become president of the United States. That's a pretty big accomplishment, right? And yet, this is interesting that his biographer said this, and she was spending the last few moments of his life with her, And he was, you know, it was in the last days, that was kind of the twilight period of his life. And she said that Lyndon B. Johnson was just pleading with her, please, he said, make something meaningful of my life. You know, he didn't feel like, man, I've accomplished everything that I need to do. So he was trying to persuade this biographer to make it look like he had done something meaningful in his life. You see, ultimately, all of the things that you achieve and success, that doesn't bring you happiness, you know? So you're going to be buried in your big fancy car, you know, behind your big fancy house. All of that really means nothing at the end. That's satisfaction really, you know, cannot be found in that type of workaholism, that work, that drive to achieve. Solomon also looked at money, right? And he basically said that wealth doesn't satisfy. Let me read this to you tonight out of the New International Version. I got two Bibles with me here tonight, one on each side. Ecclesiastes chapter 2, verses 7 and 8. This is what he said. He says, I bought male and female servants and had other slaves who were born in my house. Notice this. He says, I also owned more herds and flocks than anyone in Jerusalem before me. Verse 8, I amassed silver and gold for myself and the treasure of kings and provinces. I acquired men and women singers, goes on to say, and bought a harem as well. The delights of the heart of man. I became far greater by far than anyone in Jerusalem before me. And then down there in verse number 11, this is what he says. Yet when I surveyed all of this, he said, everything was meaningless, a chasing after the wind. Nothing was gained underneath the sun. Let me tell you something. Money does not buy happiness. I heard someone say it can buy you a pretty good imitation. Yeah, maybe so, but it can't buy long-term lasting happiness. He became at that point the wealth. You know, Solomon became actually one of the wealthiest men who ever lived. Those who have researched this say that even Getty or Sam Walton or the Hunts or the Bass Brothers, you know, all together at today have less than Solomon did in today's terms. And so, you know, he was just thinking, if I just got enough stuff, if I collected everything I could, I would be happy. And yet, he wasn't really satisfied. Just think about, you know, do you even remember what you got for Christmas just 3 or 4 months ago? Probably not, right? So anyway, stuff doesn't satisfy. Having a lot of money, it doesn't satisfy. You know, he did all kinds of things. You know, the Bible says that it took him 14 years to build his house. It was so incredibly big. And listen to this. The daily provision of food required for his household in 1 Kings 4 said this. It says it took 30 cattle and 100 sheep being slaughtered every day just to feed his household. Well, boy, there's some groceries that I'm glad I don't have to pay for, right? But anyway, he was obviously a very extravagant man, feeding lots of people every day. He had more money than any of us could imagine, and yet it proved meaningless because you always want more. Howard Hughes was asked one time, how much does it take to make a man happy? And this was his words. This is a quote. He said, just a little more. And that's what a lot of people think in their life. When I get just a little more, then I'll be happy. But let me tell you something. All you money cannot produce lasting happiness. So then he said to himself, you know, I'm going to try success. And he was a very successful person. You know, he was a famous person. Solomon in his day was famous. People came from all over the world just to sit and listen to his wisdom, to listen to his proverbs. And this is what he says in verses 9 and 11 of Ecclesiastes 2. Hope you're following along with me in your Bible, Ecclesiastes 2, 9 and 11. He says, I became greater by far than anyone in Jerusalem before me. In all this, my wisdom stayed with me. And he goes on to say in verse 11, yet when I surveyed all that my hands had done and what I had toiled to achieve, think about that, people coming, being famous, the Queen of Sheba visiting him, all kinds of royal entourages coming before him. This is what he said. Everything was meaningless, a chasing after the wind. Nothing was gained underneath the sun. And let me tell you something. Just being successful in, you know, as far as like the world's eyes are concerned, that does not produce happiness. Solomon was successful in everything he did. It seemed like everything that he touched just seemed to work out. And yet he said, I was still unsatisfied. And so here comes the big question tonight. What do you do when everything you've wanted in the world isn't enough? You know, really what you have is the making of a midlife crisis, right? Now, I've understood that there's two ways to have a midlife crisis. One way is to get to middle age and to have, you know, unfulfilled dreams, you know you're probably not going to be able to ever accomplish what you wanted to accomplish and fulfill what you wanted to fulfill with your life. And so you get frustrated over that. But there's another way to have a midlife crisis, and that's to get everything that you have wanted, to achieve all that you've ever desired, And then to sit back and go, okay, now what do I do with the rest of my life? You know, I'm a great success, you know, and that was Solomon's predicament. He got it all, tried it all, spent it all, but he was still a very unsatisfied person. There's a book entitled Quiet Desperation, The Truth About Successful Men in America, written by a psychologist, and they had surveyed successful men all across America, and they discovered that actually successful men are no more happy than unsuccessful men. And so it leads us to ask this question of what we've just been studying in God's Word tonight, right? Well, why is this book of Ecclesiastes, why is this book of Solomon even in the Bible? I think that God is trying to teach us here that there are some dead ends that we can avoid. You know, God is really saying, save your time, save your money, save your energy. Happiness isn't found in any of these things. And what happened to Solomon was that he came to this conclusion after doing all of these things, trying all of these different ways. This is what he said in Ecclesiastes 2 and verse number 17. Now, these are Solomon's words. I'm talking about the guy who's had all the pleasure, he's had all the money, he's had all the success, all the fame, all the fortune, all the women, all of this. This is what he says. So I hated life. Wow. That's pretty sad, you know? That's pretty sad. I hated life because the work that is done under the sun was grievous to me. You see, all of that success doesn't bring you happiness. Read recently about Patrick Swayze. Of course, you know, he was an actor, very famous actor. I believe he's dead now. But, you know, you'd think, you know, he would have had every reason to be happy. He just had one blockbuster hit after another. He's rich. He's handsome. You know, he's got big fan clubs, adored by a lot of people. And yet this is what Patrick Swayze said, and I quote, he says, it's true that this is what I've always dreamed of. But once I got here, I wondered why my life felt so empty. I'm not satisfied with what I've got, and I have nobody to complain to. That was Patrick Swayze's view on life. It kind of sounds a little bit like Solomon, doesn't it? There's another guy named Freddie Mercury. He's the lead singer of Queens. You know, the first rock star to actually die of AIDS. At the height of his career, you know, all the fame and fortune, this is what he said. He wrote these words. He said, what is there left for me to do in this life? Did I achieve what I set in my sights? Am I a happy man, or is this just sinking sand? was it worth it? You know, there's a lot of people that are look that they are looking at their life and they're thinking, man, is this all there is? Is this the meaning of life? You know, they don't feel happy about their life, even though they've got all kinds of things, new cars, new stuff. And Solomon was saying this. He was saying education, pleasure, achievement, wealth, success. And these are the five different things that we spend most of our lives trying to achieve. He said, look, it's not in any of those things. They're not bad things, but they just don't satisfy. So the question becomes, if those things don't bring happiness, what does?